blizzards, tornadoes, floods, high-profile events, the marathon, victory parades. That's when the Massachusetts Emergency Management Agency goes into high gear at its shelter buried underground.
The MEMA Emergency Operations Center in a bona fide bunker here in Framingham, safe and secure from any threat once this blast door is closed.
The facility was built in the early 1960s as a Cold War era command bunker for the state, and the federal government, then President Kennedy, allocated money to the state to build this underground nuclear proof facility.
This was the first of what was supposed to be one in every state. The president, unable to attend the dedication in 1963, inscribed this photo. The accompanying letter from an aide is dated November 22nd, the day JFK was assassinated. MEMA director Kurt Schwartz.
As I understand the history, some of the funding disappeared after his death. I believe that only a few were ultimately built with the federal money.
The bunker operates 24/7, 365 days a year.
This is where it happens.
We have a direct ring down phone from Logan Airport whenever they have an actual event, but more often they have an alert. Sirens around Pilgrim and Seabrook Nuclear Power Plant, the sirens are activated from here.
The false missile alert in Hawaii put everyone on notice.
We've taken the opportunity to try to understand what happened in Hawaii. Our testing platform is on a completely different system, so that if somebody is intending to do a test, there is no possibility of clicking a wrong button and actually sending out an alert live.
You mentioned it was built for the Cold War, about as secure as it can get once the door is closed. How long can you be down here if you have to be?
I hope I don't ever have to find that out, but it is certainly a secure facility. We are, underground, encased in concrete. We maintain food for 10 days or so right now. We have bunk rooms.
And here, in the bowels of the bunker, two of everything needed to survive off the grid. Designed for every eventuality, it even includes a morgue, never used.
It is also the Emergency Operations Center for the governor, lieutenant governor, their cabinet, and their key staffers. So if we think there may be a situation where multiple state agencies or multiple cities and towns are going to be dealing with an incident or event, we'll stand up to serve as a coordination body. For this year's Boston Marathon, the command center here will be about 300 people, 50 to 60 different agencies and organizations.
History lovers, listen up. This old house has stories to tell, beginning with the Salem witch trials. But we're not in Salem, rather Framingham, where Sarah and Peter Clays came in 1693, fleeing the hysteria.
Sarah's two sisters were hung. Sarah somehow escaped the noose.
A sympathetic Thomas Danforth offered her and numerous relatives land on what today is Salem End Road. In Salem, the Clays were known as Cloyce. Annie Murphy of the Framingham History Center.
She probably changed her name to Clays because she didn't want to be associated with Cloyce and Salem.
Though the house standing now came after Sarah and Peter, it is not without clues to its storied past. Have a look.
There are stories of her having to stay in the house and having to find passageways to get water so that she wouldn't have to be seen outside. So she was so fearful, one can imagine.
Underground, the unusual stonework at the base of the chimney is another link to the past.
I wish you could do dendrochronology on stones to find out when these stones were placed here. And the experts that we have contacted have said they've never seen such a crazy and intricate chimney system. So there's a lot of mystery.
Mysterious pockets that lend credence to another chapter.
The listing for the Mass Historical Commission, it says it was believed to be on the Underground Railroad. So there's a cavity in this old section with all these wild chimneys that you could go from the basement to the attic.
It may not appear so today, but the fight to save this house and the stories it harbors does have a happy ending.
The town, by making it its own historic district, put a preservation sort of caveat on it.
A nonprofit land trust is funding the restoration.
The ultimate goal is to sell it to somebody who obviously has an appreciation for old houses, but with a preservation restriction on it so that people cannot alter the most historic parts of the house. It's very unusual, and it's one reason why we had to save this house.
Speak easy or speak loudly. They don't care.
We're not hush-hush by any means.